So some of the shows that we do on this particular program are a little bit abstract in nature, or things that attract our intellectual curiosity. This show is not like this. This show is from the heart and it's from the guts. I hate my printer. You may hate your printer. People hate printers. You know the band Rage Against the Machine? That name is about printers. That's the machine. I made that up, but it could easily be true. People don't like printers. And, you know, it kind of raises the question of why. I mean, it's not as complicated as other machines. Why do printers suck so much? That's what we'll be talking about today. Also, whether there are any good printers that won't make you unhappy. And if that fails, whether there are places you can go to smash a printer. Printer phobia is coming up right after the following message.
To print stuff out. Here's how it works. There's stuff on my computer. If I want that stuff on paper, then I use my printer. I press the print button on my computer, and then my printer knows what to do. It prints.
Oh, Matt Farley, if only it were that simple. Or if only we all had your printer. Because in fact, one thing that I think is pretty well established at this point, I don't know if we have the exact data science on it, but what's pretty established at this point is that people do not like their printers. They probably dislike their printers more than they dislike any other device in their house, unless they happen to have a device that's in its own very individual way malfunctioning. So much so that in office space, when they go all out in the field to bash a printer with baseball bats and kick it and stuff like that, everybody understands what's happening. Yeah, we're four decades out from the idea of the paperless office, but nearly half of Americans still own a printer. There's just stuff you need to do with it. The Washington Post last year devoted an entire week, modeled on Shark Week, to printers, treating them as creatures who mean us harm, unlike actual sharks. And one of their conclusions, there is no good printer, only less bad printers. And most of you probably think that the problem is that the printers often don't work, which is true. They often do not. But when they do work, it's almost worse. They spy on you and play tricks on you. Their goal is to sell you ink as opposed to, you know, printing things you want printed. Here to explain a little bit more about that part of it is Cory Doctorow, science fiction author, activist with the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and journalist. His new book, The Bezel, B-E-Z-Z-L-E, if you're getting ready to order it. His new newsletter is pluralistic.net. Cory Doctorow, welcome to our conversation.
What a pleasure to be on. Thank you. And talking about one of my favorite, least favorite subjects.
So your area especially has less to do with the fact that sometimes you just want to print a document and for whatever reason, the machine will not do it. Although I think that is sometimes tied to the thing that you're more interested in, which is what else is the machine doing? What else is the company that built the machine doing in order to tighten its grip on you? But give us sort of a quick overview of what that's all about.
Well, I think most of us are familiar with how the science denial playbook was invented by Big Tobacco, but then repurposed for all kinds of things like climate denial. In the same way, the doing terrible things to people with technology racket was pretty much invented by printer companies. And so to the extent that you find yourself really angry that, you know, your Ring doorbell just doubled in price, or that Mercedes wants to rent you the accelerator pedal in your own car by the month, these are all tactics that were invented by printer companies. And those tactics involve making it illegal for you to use something that you own in a way that benefits you at the expense of the shareholders of the people who made it, and mobilizing the government to actually punish you for what Jay Freeman calls felony contempt of business model, while ensuring that that same state power is used to prevent third parties from modifying the thing that you own so that it treats you with the respect that you're due as its rightful owner.
So you got interested in this partly because HP, one of the major printer companies, was caught doing something that looked like an update. They sent in an update. It turns out they had a secondary agenda. Explain what happened here.
Yeah, so HP pushed out an update to its printers that it billed as a security update. And look, I have many decades now of experience in information security, and it is amazing how often something really terrible happens because someone didn't install the latest security update. Installing those security updates is really important. So HP sends out this security update, and you get a little notification on your printer that says, you have a new security update pending. You should click OK to install it. And for the people who installed it, the same thing happened that happens whenever you install a security update, which is your device reboots, and as far as you can tell, nothing has changed. But what had actually happened was not that your printer became more secure. It's that it got like a ticking time bomb. So this was pushed out in March. And in September, months later, right after, for example, like low-income families had gone to Costco and bought a year's worth of third-party ink for their printer, this time bomb went off. And every person who had unwisely clicked OK suddenly had their printer wake up and say, I will no longer use this third-party ink that you bought for your printer. And the reason HP did that was the same reason that viruses evolve to incubate for a long time before they show symptoms, right? The same reason that COVID is contagious for several days before you start to show symptoms. It's because if you become symptomatic straight away, you take steps to warn other people and to stay away from them. The contagion is halted. So what HP didn't want was for the first person who downloaded that patch to go online and say, wait, don't install this patch. It irreversibly breaks your printer so that it won't use your ink. They wanted to have a long period of contagion before symptoms showed so that the disease that they had deliberately unleashed among their customers would spread as far as possible. And in so doing, they not only harmed their users in the short term, but they set a precedent that it's okay for companies to lie to you about security updates, to trick you into saying you should take this medicine that will make you safer when really it's poison. And as a result, they muddied the waters so that now there are a lot of people who legitimately get their security updates and go, wait a second, is this a thing that makes me secure from bad guys or the shareholders of the manufacturer of this device secure from me?
So some of their rationale is that you're misusing their product if you use someone else's ink. This is a little bit as though Subaru were to say to me, you have to buy Subaru gas. You can't just go buy gas anywhere that you want. But that's their argument anyway, right? You got to use our ink.
Yeah. You know, that's the pitch that they gave me when I was talking to them in my capacity as a journalist and activist, is that the thing that they sold you wasn't a printer. What they sold you was a printer that uses HP ink. And that if you wanted to use it in some other way, that you were doing something illegitimate and potentially dangerous that could harm you and other people. And so they had the right to step in and defend themselves. That's like, you know, Tefal saying you didn't buy a frying pan. You bought a frying pan that fries approved eggs. And putting someone else's eggs in this frying pan is something that we have to stop you from doing for our good, but also for your good. And HP had just the best rationale. They were like, what if you're a grandparent and you're printing out the only copy you're going to save of a picture of your kids or your grandkids, and you print it using inferior ink and you don't know it. And in 15 years, that ink has faded and you've deleted the JPEG. We have to step in to stop that. When, of course, you know, the majority of things that people are printing out are like their kids' homework blanks and, you know, shopping lists and boarding cards with QR codes, you know, which is exactly why they're trying to squeeze however much money they can out of people who are using these things. Because for most of us, printers have become a thing that we only use very occasionally for things that are bureaucratic and painful. We're not just sitting there at our desk making lots of printouts all day long. And that's harming their income. And so they want to take the remaining customers who are forced by some circumstance and extract as much revenue from them as possible. You know, today they make it almost impossible to buy a printer without buying a subscription to ink, where you have to predict in advance how many pages you're going to print. And they charge you for those, whether or not you print them. And if you go over that limit, they charge you just a shocking premium on every page. So if you're like, well, twice a year I fly with that one stupid airline that requires a printed out boarding card, and you unwisely fail to untick the 11 million boxes you have to untick to not end up with an ink subscription, you now have to buy the minimum pages per month subscription to HP, or when the time comes, they're going to just ream you to print out those pages. And, you know, when they started this, they offered you printers that had lifetime minimum pages of ink, where they were like, you would get whatever, 8 pages a month forever. And then one day people woke up and they were like, yeah, it turns out that lifetime doesn't mean what you think it does. HP is now going to charge you for that minimum plan as well. That's your upgrade from now on. I call this the Darth Vader MBA. You know, I have altered the deal. Pray I don't alter it further.
Your fluency in Star Wars quotations is a tribute to you. Yeah, I mean, this is a little bit like, you know, with your own kid, you know what your kid does every day. You know how to head that kid off at the pass, ideally some of the time anyway. You kind of know what to expect. This is, your printer is more like, you know, somebody else's kids who show up 2 or 3 times a year, and you really don't know from moment to moment what they're going to do or what works. I mean, what you're saying is part of the advantage that HP and other printer companies have over us is we don't really develop any familiarity with this device. If you're familiar with something, you start to think about why it's not working, how it could be better. We don't ask a lot of questions because it is this thing that we don't use that much.
Well, there is that important sense in which this is not an iterated game. You know, this is a thing that, you know, HP plays against us hundreds of times a day collectively, but we play against HP only every couple of years when we buy a printer or, you know, make some other decision. And of course, one of the problems with all internet connected devices, and again, this is a thing that the printer industry invented, but that has metastasized into wider society, is that making a wise consumer choice at the point of sale is impossible if the device that you're buying can have its characteristics unilaterally altered by its manufacturer at some later date. You know, if you go and you get Consumer Reports and it, or the Wirecutter, and it says, these are the 3 best printers, and they're the best printers because they have these features, A, B, and C. And you're like, well, I use A, B, and C. I'm going to get the printer. And then 6 months later, they take back A and B, and they say, actually, A and B now requires that you pay us a monthly subscription. Well, that's no longer the best printer, right? And so, you know, we've been conditioned by 40 years of neoliberal orthodoxy to think that the only way that we can exist in the world is to vote with our wallets, that those are the only elections that matter. And, you know, it's increasingly apparent that the vote with your wallet election is one in which the richest people get the most ballots because they have the thickest wallets, and the monopoly party always wins. And this is an area where our individual capacity to pay attention and make good choices is completely swamped by a tortured legal system that allows these companies to make these updates, that stops other companies from making counter updates. So one of the things we haven't talked about yet is that there are laws like Section 1201 of the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, the DMCA, which is a very old law from 1998 that Bill Clinton signed, that makes it a felony to bypass a copyrighted work's access control, which includes the software for your printer. So making a thing that reverts the software for your printer so that you can restore the ability to use the third-party ink that you bought this September is illegal. Mm-hmm. And it's not just a little illegal. It's a felony punishable by a 5-year prison sentence and a $500,000 fine. So on the one hand, you have these companies acting with impunity to commit fraud. On the other hand, they have the ability to mobilize the state to punish people who undo that fraud. And really, you just end up with a problem where individuals cannot resolve it. You know, one of the questions your producer asked is like, what can we do as individuals? I guess the answer is ask your attorney general. Ask the Federal Trade Commission, which is under very muscular and revitalized control. Ask the Department of Justice, ask your local prosecutors to go after these creeps for breaking the law, and ask your congressperson to get rid of this 1998 law that allows companies to felonize changing the products that you own so that they respect your interests, even when they conflict with the manufacturer's interests.
Right. Well, Cory, one of my U.S. senators is Richard Blumenthal, and he loves stuff like this. This is just a Blumenthal press conference waiting to happen. So I'm excited about that. So, Cory, we know they want to sell us their ink because they want to sell more ink. But do they want to sell us their ink for other reasons? Like, is there stuff in the ink, like little tiny chips in the ink that's kind of helping them keep track of us and what we're doing?
No, you know what there are is there's chips in the printer cartridges. So printer cartridges, one of the things that really changed the world is when microchips got really cheap. Low powered microchips got really cheap. These are the microchips that are manufactured in China. The fancy ones are made in Taiwan. The cheap ones are made in China, and they're the ones that no one could get during lockdown. They're the ones that, you know, your car has like 25 of, one for the windshield wipers and one for the, you know, rear camera or whatever, where nobody could make cars for like a year during lockdown. It's these chips, these low power chips. And what these chips do is something called parts pairing. More generally, it's sometimes called VIN locking, which is where you have a little cheap microchip. And when you put the printer cartridge in the printer, the central control unit of the printer, which is a more beefy, muscular chip, it sends a message to the cheap chip and it says, here is a random number, sign it with the encryption key that was installed in you at the manufacturer, and send me back that signed random number, and that way I'll know that you're a real chip. This is the same thing Apple does to make sure that when you put a screen from one broken phone into a working phone, that it doesn't work unless an Apple technician types in the unlock code, which means that you can't get your phone fixed at an independent technician who will charge you less and even, you know, keep your phone running for longer than Apple thinks you should. Apple CEO Tim Cook gave a press conference in 2019 or sent out an investor letter in 2019 where he said, you know, our biggest problem as Apple is that people fix their phones instead of replacing them. So by forcing you to get your phone fixed by Apple, they get to decide when they say, actually, this phone's beyond repair, what we'll offer you a trade-in and you can get a new phone, which solves Apple's shareholders' problem. So this parts pairing is the thing that the printer does too. It says, like, are you the real chip, the real cartridge? And because the chip has an encryption code and because that's covered by this old 1998 Clinton-era law, the only way that chip can send back the correct response is if it's one of the manufacturer's chips or if someone has risked a prison sentence to clone the manufacturer's chip. This is used across the board, right? Medtronic, who are the leading med tech vendor in the world, they use this for their ventilators. So during lockdown, hospitals that were like taking a screen out of a dead ventilator and putting it in a ventilator with a dead screen, they couldn't get it to work. Your listeners might have heard about John Deere tractors doing this to stop farmers from making their own repairs. The farmer still makes the repair. They swap the part into the broken tractor, but it won't work until they pay a couple $100 and wait a couple of days for a John Deere technician to come out and just type an unlock code into the keyboard. And again, this 1998 law, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, makes it a felony to do any other thing in order to keep your tractor running, even if there's a storm coming and you need to bring the crops in, to keep your ventilator running, even if there's a once in a century global pandemic, or, you know, to get third-party ink to be recognized by your printer so that you don't have to spend $10,000 a gallon to print your boarding card.
You know, when you talk, I feel as though we, as customers, you know, entering this whole marketplace, I mean, we're like sort of rubes from the country showing up in New York City, and within an hour, somebody sold us a knockoff Louis Vuitton bag on Canal Street, and somebody else has given us, sold us 10% of the Statue of Liberty and stuff. I mean, we tend to be probably a little bit more trusting than we should. And for example, reading your stuff and going to some of the stuff that you link to, you know, sometimes they're selling us printers where the ink cartridge is only half. But the one that killed me, because I see it all the time on my own printer, is that whole calibration thing, right? And a lot of times my computer just, I mean, my printer wants to recalibrate, and I'm looking at it and I'm saying, you know, you've only printed like a couple of pages since the last time you recalibrated. I'm impressed with your vigilance, printer, but I'm wondering if this is necessary. But because I'm a trusting rube with a straw hat on the back of my head, right? The printer's doing that so it can use up more ink.
Yeah, you know, that's a great wheeze. There are several of these. So you know, think about this from the printer manufacturer's perspective. And you know, I've been picking on HP, but they're all doing this, Epson brother. They've all been caught doing variations on this. But you know, imagine this from like the printer vendor's perspective, the story they're going to tell you. It's like, what if you were to print that boarding card and your QR code, instead of being 100% black, was 98% black? Imagine the horror that you and the ground crew are going to share when you look at the inferior printing on your cartridge. There's so many variations on this. Yeah, they're selling you half empty cartridges. They're also configuring the printers to refuse to use the last of the ink in the cartridge. And again, their story here is, oh, well, the ink is too old and it might damage your printer, or you know, well, the moon is in Venus, right? Mercury's in retrograde. They also will sometimes say, we can't scan your document if you don't have all of your printer cartridges full, or you can't print your black and white document unless you have blue ink full up in your printer. We just refuse to print this black and white document. It's really important to see here that what's going on is not that your printer can't do these things. It's that it's being programmed to not do these things. It won't do these things. And this is the thing that I think should both affront and alarm us, because as more and more of our world is digitized, from our insulin pumps to our home automation systems that control our door locks, the idea that you have a computer that is designed to kind of treat 2001: A Space Odyssey as a suggestion instead of a warning, where I'm sorry, I can't let you do that, is a feature and not a bug, is really, you know, grotesque. I mean, as a science fiction novelist, this really offends me because it is very bad science fiction. I couldn't get away with putting this in a novel. You know, the reason the world ended is that the manufacturer devices that thwart their owners' interests, and the government stepped in to make it a felony to undo those wishes.
You know, it's weird because as a journalist, I've spent a lot of times over the decades telling people who believe in conspiracy theories, you should first assume incompetence. That's often the reason that things are not working the way they're supposed to work or something seems to be wrong. There's a lot of incompetence in government and elsewhere. So think that before you think conspiracy. This is the opposite because I just sort of been thinking all along that, you know, HP doesn't really make a very good printer, but it turns out it's not incompetence, it's calculation. Cory Doctorow, we're honored to have you with us, a science fiction author, activist with the Electronic Frontier Foundation, journalist. His new book, The Bezel, his new newsletter is pluralistic.net. Thanks so much for being with us, Cory.
Oh, my pleasure. Yeah, thank you very much. And I'll just finish by saying, you know, Lily Tomlin used to do this bit where she'd play an AT&T operator doing commercials for the Bell system, and they'd always end with, "We don't care. We don't have to. We're the phone company." And I think that's the way to understand this. When HP knows that they have you by the short hairs, they don't have to care. You've already made the purchase decision. You've sunk the cost of the printer, so they can reach into it and tinker with it and change its internals to make things worse for you. And so long as the way that they made it worse is less bad than the cost of buying a new printer, they're just going to go ahead and do it.
We'll take a little break. We'll come back with more. And we're back. We are going to talk in just a second to Alan St. John, multimedia content producer for Consumer Reports, where they test printers. They test everything, but they really test things. They buy them, they push them to their limits, they see what they can do. Before we go to Alan, though, I know Lynn from Guilford is a little bit pressed for time, so let's get Lynn up here right now. You're on the air with a story of kind of hacking a printer to make it a little less of a nuisance. Lynn, tell us about this.
Hi, thank you for taking my call. We were having trouble printing out black and white documents because we were out of yellow ink. So I was able to find a hack online for a brother printer, and it involved covering over the laser that went through the cartridge to tell how full it was.
So, yeah. So, I mean, first of all, think about the insanity of your initial statement. the printer wouldn't print in black and white because there was no yellow ink.
Right.
So, and just out of curiosity, on a scale of 1 to 10, when you and your household discovered this, how angry was the angriest person about this?
It was me, and it was pretty angry because I used to do CAD, so I know about printing large documents and making maps, and I was pretty astonished that the household printer was working in this way. And luckily, the printer that we have the cartridge isn't weighed, it's not by the weight, it's sending a laser light through it, so we were able to cover the light, or where the light went through, with a piece of black electrical tape, and that put it back in, and it's been working fine ever since.
Well, that's great, and you have a lot of ingenuity. I don't have that. I just want my printer to work. I don't want to know how it works, and I certainly don't want to know how I might make it do something it didn't plan to do so that it would work better. But that's me. I am, however, a member of and therefore subscriber to Consumer Reports. I'm very excited to have, as I said, Alan St. John, multimedia content producer for Consumer Reports, with us. Welcome to our conversation.
It's totally great to be here. Really excited. And I can tell that your listeners are really our people, too.
Yeah, they definitely are. They're way more ingenious than I am, that's for sure. So, you know, overall, one of the things that Consumer Reports felt comfortable saying for the record was that printers are a strange kind of investment. I mean, you're buying something where you tend to pay a lot of attention to the cost up front. But that isn't even necessarily the thing that's going to most affect your satisfaction with it. Not how much it cost when you bought it, but how much it cost to own it. But say more about that.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's really easy to sort of, you know, look at, you know, what the price is and how much money you have in your bank account. And okay, I'm going to buy the cheapest thing that's actually going to work. And for most of us, again, you know, printing out, you know, permission slips and other, you know, silly things. So, you know, it's not about the ultimate quality. So sure, why won't that $79 printer, you know, be the right thing? The problem, of course, is it's not even complicated math. It's simple math. The problem is that $79 printer, you know, give or take, the something, you know, under $100 is likely to be, it's going to cost you every time about $70 a year in ink. So then all of a sudden you're looking at, you know, in 3 years, it's, you know, $210 on top of what you paid for it. So therefore, all of a sudden, you know, it seemed like a great buy to begin with, but then, you know, now all of a sudden you're feeding it $70 a year worth of ink, and you're going to have to keep doing that, you know, for as long as you want to continue to use it. And that's, you know, just simply not a great investment. And so again, I mean, when we're, you know, this is something that we, you know, include in our ratings, and we tend to steer people toward, you know, we tend to steer people towards the long view of this, that there are other printers where, you know, the ink costs are substantially lower, and also printers simply that just, you know, generally people like, actually. There are actually people who like their printers, believe it or not, and I'm happy to tell you about that.
Yes, in fact, on social media, we have heard from people also who like their printers. We've heard from way more people who don't like their printers. But yeah, one thing that you say in the Consumer Reports article too is most people own inkjet printers. Most people don't like their printers, and there's exactly a connection.
Yes. Well, the thing is, I mean, you know, for one thing to realize is I think that people sort of think that because they bought their printer at a Best Buy or someplace like that, it's really a device. And most of our quote unquote devices work pretty well and work better. And the new one works better than the last one. Your phone, your laptop, things like that. They're really, you know, durable devices. And, you know, it takes an awful lot to break them. And they think of a printer as kind of the same sort of box. It's a box that you plug in. It's a box that you connect to with Wi-Fi. So therefore, it's kind of, we think of it in the same way. And the answer is it's not. When you actually get into your printer a little bit and look at those cartridges, look at all the stuff that's in there. It is a very complicated little machine. And the problem is, it is one, a complicated little machine and with lots of little wires, lots of, you know, springs and all sorts of other things to try to make the paper move and try to make the print heads move and do all sorts of things like that. So that's, the first part of it. So you get, again, just have this thing, it's a little machine. And the other problem, of course, is that unlike, printers of a couple generations ago, which were sort of, built to last, at this point, printers are designed to hit price points, especially inkjet printers are designed to hit price points. And so then all of a sudden you get a situation where, this thing is, that's a very complicated device, is also built to basically the lowest possible standard. And so, of course, you're going to get something that's going to be pretty frustrating.
Absolutely. So one thing that you could do is not buy an inkjet printer. That probably means you're going to buy a laser printer. That probably means it's going to cost a little bit more than the inkjet printer. But say some more about why that might be an advantage.
Exactly. Well, the thing is, and we do surveys of and one of the things we do in our surveys, we ask people how they use their devices. And, and one of the things we ask, printer users is, how do you use your device? And most people, and it certainly, jibes with my experience, they just, you're printing that, it's a form, you're almost always printing in black and white, and that's that. And the fact is that a black and white laser printer is just a much more robust device, and the people who buy them, they really like them. They like them because they just kind of flat out work. You just send something to print, it just keeps printing. It doesn't get, and one of the things, for example, that we nodded to this a little bit before, but an inkjet printer, regardless of whether you're using it or not, it basically needs to go through these maintenance cycles to basically use ink to periodically clean the print heads so that they stay unclogged. And the fact is, and if you were to say disable that or just simply unplug it, the problem is then you get to the point where you essentially are trying to print with clogged print heads. And we've all sort of had that experience where we're going to try to print something important, the kid's project that's due the next day. And all of a sudden you find that it's just printing in streaks and it's just all funky, and you're having to run 17 different kinds of print head cleaning protocols to basically just get this thing, get your printer to work. For the most part, you just don't have that with a laser printer. A laser printer, it prints in black and white, and it just gives you what you want, and that's why people love them. And they're not really terribly expensive. You can basic brother printer was about $159, which is a little bit more than some of the cheaper inkjets, but it's not sort of crazy expensive, and the thing's gonna just last. And in addition to that, toner is much less expensive than ink. Ink is one of the most. Ink is $70-$75 an ounce when you actually do the math, and I mean that's crazy. I mean that's that's way more than champagne. That's way more than just about really anything that a normal person's going to use. And yet, this is what we're feeding our printers. On the other hand, the laser printers, they use toner, and they use it pretty economically. And you're only going to be spending, in the ballpark of, $10 to $15 a year, on toner for even if you print a lot.
I haven't used a laser printer in a long time. Do they require special paper?
Nope. Oh. Absolutely not.
Excellent.
Just plain old, same old regular paper that we all use. Yeah, they're just great.
I want to ask one more thing about, and this may not have come up in your testing, although everything comes up in Consumer Reports testing.
Our testers are amazing.
So one of the problems that I have with my, one of the many problems I have with my printer is that it will only talk to one of the laptops in the house. I have no idea why that is, but none of the laptops are recognized by it, or none of the laptops recognize it. I don't even know how to describe that problem. There used to be a big old clunky cable that you would run from your computer to the printer. That's, ancient history now. But to me, that's another problem. Is just now, I don't, could be because there's two different gigahertz levels of wireless. I don't know what's happening, but that strikes me as a whole other issue.
this is, yeah, that's actually a pretty complicated issue. And honestly, you know, I would actually get some of my other colleagues to come in and help because, you know, well, Nicholas De Leon, who writes about laptops, probably talk about that side of it. And also, and maybe it's even your router mm-hmm. that's involved with this. But the fact is, though, you did actually raise a pretty important point. Yes. You know, you can literally just take a cable and plug it into the back of your into the back of your printer and into your computer. And that's often just, you know, the easy way of dealing with things. It feels kind of, you know, it feels kind of retro. But on the other hand, if you all you want to do is, you know, print out three pages, you know, just go buy a cable and plug it in.
Oh, I love that idea. I didn't even know that was possible.
It is.
Oh, I'm so excited. So
and cables are cheap.
Yeah, it's nice if something is cheap. Andrew from Shelton, you have a question about ink here?
Yes. Well, first of all, I love your show. Secondly, I do like my printer. It is an HP inkjet printer. However, I love it because I seldom print with it. I usually use it as a scanner, and I do keep myself as paperless as possible. However, having just realized that I signed on for one of these ink contracts with HP. Is there a way I can get out of that? I mean, is there a way I can, just buy ink when I need it rather than have this monthly price that I'm paying?
You know, Andrew, you may have to go to Betty Ford and get into a group there and admit you have no control over your relationship to ink. And I think they might be able to give you some help. This might be outside of your purview, Alan. I mean, these contracts should be cancelable just the way, you know, where you can unsubscribe to anything. But Alan, do you have any information on your end?
Yeah, I think it's exactly that. The idea being that can theoretically cancel these things. The problem is, of course, they don't make it easy to do that. And that's, you know, that's just sort of, you know, business 101. And, you know, so, you know, but as far as that's concerned, this is a matter of principle here. So the fact is, I would, you know, that maybe it's exactly. Actually, you know, at some level in terms of, you know, cost benefit, it might actually be cheaper to just continue to pay for the ink and not waste the time. But it's a matter of principle. And so, you know, if I would tell the caller, hey, go out there and just figure out exactly what it is you need to cancel this and, you know, get your money back, especially considering the fact that you're really not using it.
Right. And sometimes, as Cory covered, the computers have now been sort of have new patches on them. They won't accept third-party ink. And that brings up another thing, Alan. So we talked about laser jets. There's another thing that people can do. I mean, Andrew likes his printer, except for this one thing. So he's probably not a candidate. But there are printers, I guess, that have kind of tanks into which you pour the ink as opposed to having to buy a new cartridge every single time.
Exactly. That's actually the kind of printer that I have. And they're awesome. I mean, you know, they didn't used to be awesome. You know, a few years ago, they were okay. They, you know, we liked the idea, but the execution wasn't great. And over the last couple of years, you know, companies have just simply gotten their act together on this. And the fact is, again, you know, these ink tank printers are just, you know, again, you have some of the same issues in terms of them being kind of fragile machines that you have with any inkjet printer. So there's that. But the fact is, they cost almost nothing. I mean, it's like literally, you know, $3, $5 a year, depending upon the company, and that's it. I mean, these will, you know, a lot of these will come with enough ink already installed in them to like print for like 3 years or something. I literally, in the time that I've had my printer, I have never ever had to refill the ink. And I don't even, you know, I'm not even sure I know how to do it, partially because it just keeps printing, and that's awesome. And so again, you know, that's, and these, you know, tank printers, as they call them, are a little bit more expensive than, you know, the cartridge printers. But the fact is that, you know, you're saving so much money in the, you know, in the short, you know, in the long run. I mean, in the short run, yeah, you might end up having to pay $250 or something like that for one of these printers. But the fact is, if it's $3, $5 a year, $7 a year, less than $10 a year for ink all of a sudden compared to that other printer where you're paying $70 a year, you know, there's no contest. And basically it's, you know, savings that just keeps accruing, you know, instead of, you know, feeding three 20s and a 10 to your printer every year, you're basically taking coins out of your pocket.
They should just do that. They should do it like the vending machines. You could just slide the bills in here, take my money. So yeah, I mean,
all for that.
You know, even though some companies, like I think HP does send me a little pouch where I can mail back the spent cartridges to them, and they let them put them in a cartridge farm where they can run around and be free for the rest of their lives. I'm guessing a Tank printer is producing less e-waste and is probably kinder to the environment than a cartridge-based printer.
Exactly. In fact, that's actually something that's new that we're doing at Consumer Reports. We're sort of a green choice recommendation for some products, and it's something we're going to be rolling out with printers soon. And the fact is that you know, exactly that. One, you want devices that are going to last, you know, over, that have good reliability, and you don't want to send your whole printer, you know, to a landfill. But more to the point, you don't want that, you know, and that's to some degree a little bit unpredictable. What's very predictable is that if you use the ink, and the printer is going to continue to use the ink, whether you print things or not, as I said, in these maintenance cycles, at a certain point, you know, after a few months or a year or whatever it is, you're going to have to take all of the ink cartridges out, and maybe you can recycle them, maybe you can't. But in any case, it's certainly worse than, you know, essentially not having to do any of that at all, which is what you have with the Tank printer, where, you know, you just have the tanks that are sitting sitting inside the unit, and that's great. And, you know, and the same thing also with, you know, laser printers, the toner cartridges, they just last a long time, and you're going to just have less e-waste, and that's just good for all of us.
It is indeed. We're going to stop there. I do recommend to people that they join Consumer Reports and get their subscription, and they can get all these great recommendations. And this stuff is really, really, really rigorously tested. Alan St. John is multimedia content producer for Consumer Reports. Thanks for being with us.
Oh, thanks so much. This was awesome. Love talking printers.
Now, another way that you could produce a lot of e-waste that wouldn't be great would be if you had a machine that you got so angry at that you started smashing it with a baseball bat, because there's stuff inside your printer probably you shouldn't be smashing. But there might be a place where you could go and safely do something kind of like that. In fact, there is such a place. And in the next segment, we will talk to someone at one of those places. And it's time to say some thank yous. One of them is to Kat Pastor. She's our technical producer today and most days. Also, thanks to Lily Tyson, the senior producer of the Colin McEnroe Show and the producer of this episode. Special thanks to Gina Matruda, who runs around saving the day here all the time and did that yet again. All right. So, yes, I promised you Hulk smash. So, Iron Man says it so much better. Hulk smash. And here to talk about that is Cody Nicholas, co-owner of the Lose It Rage Room in Woodbridge, Virginia. Cody, welcome to our show.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
So the concept here is there's a place where you can go and you can smash stuff. But I'm guessing people don't want to smash a blender as often as they want to smash a printer. What percentage of the rage object continuum is printers? How big a market is that?
A
close to 100%. Like, everyone wants one, and we always have a lot. Like, there's always a printer or two or three that people are offering us. We're going to get a ton of them. So printers are, there's a ton of them not working out there.
Yes, defunct printers is a saturated market, definitely. And so do you have to do stuff with them beforehand? I mean, sometimes things have, you know, if they have lithium batteries inside them or motherboards or stuff, you might have to take that stuff out, right?
Yeah, batteries and ink cartridges, toner cartridges, we look for it all. If we can't take it out, then we give it back to whoever, because we buy it in the bulk, you know, so we'll say we can't take these, but we can take these, and then we go from there.
Right. Because, I mean, some things are actually dangerous to smash, and some things are environmentally unsound to smash. So you've done this. You've smashed a printer. First of all, like, how long does it take? I mean, I guess you could continue just to beat on it and curb stomp it well after it no longer was recognizable. But sort of talk about the time cycle here.
So you have some, you know, big, you know, professional athlete on one sledgehammer swing or two, it's done. Then you have the people that, you know, take them a little more time, a little more gentle with it. It could take a little more, but either, you know, each hit with whatever, you're going to take a little piece off here or there, or you're going to take a big chunk off.
Because you want something. I mean, another thing about the printer, I think it's mainly people are mad at the printers for all the reasons that we've discussed here on the show. But it also probably is a fairly satisfying thing to smash, because there's things that can kind of break noisily, and you can kind of feel the effect of your efforts. Am I
close?
Yeah. Yeah. And you want to say a little bit more? You've done this. I mean, just describe the feelings of smashing a printer.
You were correct. Seeing, you know, one piece fly off, you hit it again, some more flies off. It's satisfying, cathartic to do that with a bat or a sledgehammer. Something you really can't describe, just, you know, feeling the, you know, feeling the bat. It's really hard to describe until you do it.
And we should say that, you know, this is obviously something that people probably think about doing on their own. People would come up with the idea of smashing a printer just out of their own frustration with their printers. But there's also an iconic movie scene, which we would play for you right now, except that there are no spoken words really in this movie scene. It's from the movie Office Space. Three of the characters wind up out in a field. It's like they drag the printer out to the Pine Barrens or something, and they're going to put it away.
I know the song too.
You know the song too, which we also, I think, can't play for a different reason.
Right.
So, but I don't. Do people mention that scene? Do people? Does that come up? Yeah.
You're right. You're right on point with that.
I guess we have found a clean version of the song. Do people do it? Like, so I think it's significant in the movie Office Space that it's three guys doing it together, because there's a kind of collective rage. Is that an option at your place, or do people have to do their dirty work alone?
Yes, there is a option to have a team building type deal, team building, if you want to call it that, family events and just any kind of group activity where that would be fun, we do that.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to talk about it in terms of team building, because obviously you're doing the opposite of building.
Right.
You're kind of unbuilding. But I would imagine that's a fun office party, right? I mean, just to go out there and for one day stop pretending you like all this stuff that you've got to use at work.
Absolutely. You're spot on. Like, that's exactly what we have. Like, during the week, you know, they'll take some time and call us up and ask for a team building workshop with whatever, from dentists to veterinarians, to doctors, to nurses, teachers, church groups, you name it. They've been here, or they've asked us to travel them and bring the kind of the rage stuff to them.
I really don't like the idea of my dentist wanting to smash things.
But believe it or not, yeah, it happened.
I love my dentist. She would never do anything like that. So just imagine, final question here, if I wanted to pack up my staff and head on down to Virginia so we could smash some stuff up, what's that going to run us? What's the price of doing something like that?
If you have six or less, it runs about $50 a person, and that would include the items to break and the time. And if you go up more than that, it's around about the same price. So around $50 a person, mm-hmm. You can go on our website and Let us know how many you have, and we'll take care of you.
All right. Lily Tyson is nodding. She wants to do this. All right. Cody Nicholas, thanks so much. Cody Nicholas is co-owner of the Lose It Rage Room in Woodbridge, Virginia. And thanks very much for listening. Be kind to your printer today. But tomorrow, you can just beat the crap out of it.
When we get done, you know what I'm saying? Ghetto Boys, 1996, the year 2000 and forever. And don't stop until I say it's over with me. You know what I'm saying?